Y seguimos con el próximo ponente en inglés de nuevo, Jonathan Levis, director comercial en Teads. What's next for video advertising? Así que, si le han puesto ya el micro, ok. It's your turn. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sound wasn't supposed to be there, apologies. My name's Jonathan. I've been here for about 7 hours. I haven't understood a word. I might have to leave halfway through. I might use that car to go to the airport. I think I'm going to be late. I don't know why that car's here. I run Teads Studio in EMEA. Teads Studio is part of Teads. For those of you that don't know, Teads is the world's largest video platform, reaches 1.2 billion people. Every month globally, and in Spain we did around 80% of the digital audience, all verified and so forth by Comscore, of course. So I'm going to talk to you a bit about video and the future of video. It's quite a big topic, it's quite a daunting topic, the future. I know it's quite late, I know a lot of you like me have been here for 7 hours or more, so we're going to try and make this nice and visual, not too much text, not too much data. And hopefully enjoyable. So we are going to begin with a bit of text, though, because I think when you're talking about the future, you always run the risk of making a complete arse of yourself. As the head of Decca Records once did when he didn't sign the Beatles, he thought they were crap and there was no room in the world for four-piece bands. The makers of the Titanic, of course, were convinced that the bloody thing wouldn't sink. Unfortunately, it did. And the vice president at 20th Century Fox thought there was no life in TV, no world for TV. So I'm going to give you just a short look forward, so not too far into the future, a bit now and a bit into the future. But in order, before we go forward, I think it's always useful to go back, right? So we're going to start with the first ever printed ad in 1472. This was from a guy called William Caxton, who took Gutenberg's printing press to the UK. He was publishing books. He published Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. And he went around putting his ads on church doors, right, advertising the fact that he was publishing books. 300 years later, we get the first newspaper ad published in the US. This was published in the Boston Globe, actually appeared in the letter section, somebody trying to sell their property. In 1842, the first advertising agency was founded. This was a quasi-advertising agency. Ultimately, they aggregated lots of newspaper subscriptions and newspaper advertising opportunities and sold that. So if you kind of want to go to the genesis of where Teads began, aggregating premium publishers, you can go back to 1842. And the first Spanish agency founded by Rafael Banolas in 1872, and again, working solely with newspapers. So I always kind of think that agencies should be a bit more protected of newspapers because their heritage is from there. 1922, advertising moves to the airways, so we get our first radio ad. Interestingly enough, this ad was 10 minutes long. So in less than 100 years, we've gone from creating 10-minute content to being told that we now actually need to create 3-second content because we're all stupid and our attention spans are very low. And then the big one in 1941.
America runs on Bulova time.
First TV ad. America now runs on Trump time, of course. And if you don't like that, you are very, very bad people and you cannot come to America. That was an impression of Donald Trump. 1994, a blow to creatives everywhere. The first banner ad appears. This horrible thing got a click-through rate of 44%, which is outrageous. There weren't many people online at the time, of course. This was pre-Google. Our search engines were AltaVista and Highwire. Google does launch, and then following that, YouTube sparks a video revolution, 2005. Then we have social, Facebook, Twitter, and so forth. 2011, Teads invent Outstream. Now, of course, I'm going to mention this as a key point. Outstream is now mainstream. For those of you who are unaware of Outstream, it's video that appears within content pages. It gives publishers the opportunity to monetize video, an opportunity they might not have had before with a lack of content for video. So at Teads, we work with 80% of all the premium publishers globally. And then 2016, and kind of where we are now, mobile's taken over, right? Nearly 5 billion people, or by the end of this year, 5 billion people own a mobile phone, and more than half of them will be connected to the internet. So we live in a mobile world. We've undergone substantial change since William Caxton was running around sticking ads on doors. We're very much in a video world as well. Cisco predict that by the end of 2019, 80% of all video traffic, all internet traffic, will be from video. As we've just seen with the previous presentation, our ads have come a long way. We create beautiful, cinematic-esque content. This is an ad for one of my favorite ads last year for Under Armour, a great ad. So we've come a long way, thankfully, from Bullover. We've created interactive experiences. So we give our users the ability to spend more time with our brands, to validate the brand, to find out more about certain products, take 360 tours, access more videos, access additional content, engage them, provide content that they want to engage with. And of course, we've become more targeted. We use a lot of audience targeting for our video these days. And if you work with the right provider that allows you third-party verification, then we've definitely become more measurable, so we can see the effects of all of our campaigns. So the future could look a little bit like this. So our video ads will continue to be interactive 2.0, if you like. They'll definitely be mobile. They'll need to be mobile. They'll be self-assembled, so we'll be using artificial intelligence to deliver individual creative to you in the right environment, and they'll be conversational. So we're going to go through each one of those one at a time. The first one is interactive. So we've been working with some brands, helping them create interactive content. Okay, so a bit different to the version that we just saw, where you had a call to action that launched a slate that you can do anything. In this instance, we're actually making the content itself interactive. So the user controls the journey. The user chooses his or her own adventure. I'm going to show you a clip of an ad of some creative we did with Bupa. Bupa is a private healthcare company in the UK. They wanted people, predominantly young people, to think about the effects their lifestyle was having on their body. And this all came about due to a survey that Bupa held in the UK. And amongst other things, 67 respondents in the UK didn't know what their kidneys were for. So this speaks volumes for the general intelligence of the UK at the moment, and will give you a bit of an insight as to why we've just Brexited. I did promise somebody I wouldn't mention Brexit, but I can't. So let's have a look at this creative. There's 57 different bits, short form bits of content. The user chooses based on a number of different questions, and then at the end we stitch that content together, and there are 175 different variations here. And the musician plays based on that user choice. Ba, 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 ba. If you don't smoke, you sing well. If you smoke, you sing like a dog. So once those users make all of those choices, we algorithmically stitch these all together and deliver a personalized record or a personalized cue, right, with the video.
When we meet, I listen to your heartbeat. I can hear the rhythm.
You get the picture, right? This was delivered to over... I was delivered to over 9 million people in the UK. The great thing about it, it had an average engagement rate or time spent with that ad of over 3.5 minutes. So it was a real powerful bit of content, and it's a great way to get users to kind of engage with the brand, right? I think I heard somebody, or somebody told me earlier, that somebody was sure that brands weren't taking risks or brands were boring. So I think that's a great way showcasing that it can be quite the opposite. Our creative is going to be powered by data. We have a wealth of data available to us. I think many people have spoken about this today. First-party data, second-party data, third-party data, where we can really use that to drive personal video experiences. So the example I'm going to show you is for Virgin Trains. And in this, we're powering the creative with live data specific to a geo, right? So this is a UK ad. Okay, so the bit in the middle, the 25 and the 1685, that's real-time pricing pulled via an API from Virgin Trains' website. So we're giving the user the immediacy of real-time pricing. It's targeted based on their location, right? And this is where we need to get to your video. We need to get closer or further away from the one-to-many approach and closer to a kind of one-to-one type approach. Mobile was our second pillar. If it doesn't work on mobile, it doesn't work full stop, right? We saw the numbers for mobile. It's increasingly important that we adapt our creatives to work on it. By and large, This is very sensitive, isn't it? Okay, by and large, I'm going to talk over this bit. So by and large, we have 360 video, we have AR, we have VR, but mostly when we're talking about video, what we're talking about is a repurposed TVC creative, right? So the challenge comes that we need to find ways in which we can adapt that creative for mobile experiences. In general, they can come in square and vertical formats, which you see either side. But it's important, especially from a brand perspective, that you don't mess with that creative by stretching it. And it's important we give the user the ability to view the creative as it was fully intended. So what I'm going to show you is a clip of my favorite ad of last year. This bit of creative, you might have seen it, it's for Kenzo. It's an amazing bit of content. I don't think you'll ever see a perfume ad like this. But you can go to YouTube and view it on YouTube. A great bit of beautiful brand creative. And what I want to do is adapt that for vertical. So the studio can take that creative. We load it into the studio. We showcase it in its kind of intended habitat, right? Which is landscape video. And then we change our canvas, and then we move that into portrait. We lock it into place. So that's how it traditionally appears, right? 16:9, waste of space above and below. With one click, we can make that ad vertical without cutting off 33% one side and 33% the other side, and then allow the user to navigate using his gyroscope on the phone each other bits, each the sides of the content, right? So you kind of don't get rid of that rich, wonderful kind of brand experience. I'm going to move on from that one. Subtitles. So I think in the future, it's imperative that all of our mobile creative has subtitles. In the main, most of that creative is accessed with sound off. So as a brand, how do you ensure that your message is getting across? If I had my way, which I very rarely do. All of our Teeds creative would all have subtitles. I think we'd get there to the point. So at a point, so when sound is off, subtitles are on. When sound is on, subtitles are off. Pretty simple, but not something that's kind of generally done. Okay. The third pillar is self-assembled ads. So data is a key component of this. And using artificial intelligence, we'll be able to create personalized, data-driven, interactive ads that are assembled on the fly. Last week or 2 weeks ago at Mobile Conference, Coca-Cola announced its intention to start using artificial intelligence to power its creative. And it's really kind of pretty straightforward. We take lots of disparate assets, so brand guidelines, CRM tools of all the databases of images, videos, all that data from campaigns, previous campaigns, first-party data, logos, assets, and we combine all that in real time. Okay, so that might seem a bit abstract. So let's have a look at it in a real case environment. So this is a square, this is a mock-up of a square video for John Lewis in the UK. When you click the call to action, in the background, lots of decisioning is being made, right? So what's this user? Is this user female? Is this user male? What data do we have on them? What products can we show them? So in real time, we're able to self-assemble the creative in the background, and all this happens in milliseconds. And deliver that creative to the user. If it's not in a square environment, it could be in a landscape environment where that user would be more akin to tap or to purchase. So all of this is powered by AI and a branch of AI called deep learning. We primarily use AI at the moment for business decisioning, analytics and so forth, but it's being used more and more from a creative perspective. There's a great project by JWT in Amsterdam, and ironically, JWT, the oldest creative agency still in existence, and they're pioneering this kind of stuff. There's no way that creative agencies are going to die. So the project here was with ING to create a museum-grade Rembrandt, just by using data, algorithms, facial recognition, and a 3D printer. So they analyzed around 400 different Rembrandts. They came up with a framework of what they needed to produce, and that was, had to be a portrait of a Caucasian male, had to wear those nice hats and the fluffy little collars, and he had to be facing to the right. So using a 3D printer, they managed to recreate this one here. They managed to recreate a museum-grade Rembrandt to 149 or 150 million pixels. So how is AI making all of this possible? Lots of people talk about AI, but it's quite difficult sometimes to understand quite how it works. Well, our computers now have the ability to learn. They've got the access to lots of data, and they're becoming really, really cost-effective. There's something called Moore's Law that says that every 24 months, we're able to double the amount of receptors on a computer chip. So computers are getting smaller, and they're getting faster. Okay? No other industry is advancing at the speed of which computing is advancing. The standard analogy is if you take a car, so if you take a car from 1971 and it progressed at the same speed as computing would progressed, then that car's speed would be 420 million miles per hour. So just to give you an idea of the computation power. It's affecting all walks of life. Some are embracing it in good ways. Havas have formed Cognitive. Cognitive works solely with IBM's Watson, which is one of the only things that predicted that Donald Trump would be the next American president. So Donald really likes that. I'm going to stop with that. Havas. In more worrying areas for Coco, life insurance have just booted out 34 employees and replaced them with IBM's Watson, artificial intelligence, which can read and analyze insurance claims, right? So they're no longer needed. So this is going to be an interesting area, and if used and harnessed correctly, it could be a great boon for video. I'm going to move these on for time. The last two areas I'm going to talk about are conversational advertising. Primarily, this is the integration of message interfaces into video. So messaging has exploded over the last couple of years. Facebook Messenger has a billion users, has more than it's growing quicker than Facebook. The four biggest messaging platforms are now bigger than the four biggest social platforms. Brands are building chatbots on top of Facebook Messenger. There's around 40,000 chatbots currently. And brands are using this opportunity to learn, to understand, to communicate, and respond to complaints, because we love complaining, with their users in real time. So it's become a really useful tool. So the interesting thing for me is how we can integrate those interfaces into a video proposition. So we should be launching something in the next couple of weeks. I wanted to give you a sneak preview of the things that we've been working on. This isn't the actual ad, but this gives you a general indication as to how those things can work. So this is a mock-up for Tommy Hilfiger, a vertical video, a call to action at the bottom that says chat to us. That might change. And when somebody clicks on that, then that launches the messaging interface, right? So the great thing about Tommy's chatbot is it uses quick prompts, right? So the user hasn't got to spend time typing. So we can just choose and go through the experience all the way down to adding something to basket level. So it's a really interesting area. I think we'll see a lot more of this kind of stuff. It's obviously applicable in any kind of video format, whether it's mobile, vertical, or landscape. Secondary to conversational is voice. So to my mind, if Amazon, Google, Facebook are spending billions of pounds in one area, it's probably worth you going and have a look at what they're doing. So voice has had a really great year last year with Google Now, Siri, and in particular Alexa, which is an extraordinary device. And I think if we go back to Moore's law and you think about the computation power of adding two receptors to a chip, that can only go on for so long, right? So hardware has its limitations. So the next kind of evolution is going to be in software, and voice falls under that. So I'm just going to show you just a little clip of how that might work. Again, we're talking future stuff, right? So this is a proof of concept.
Hello.
That's me, by the way.
This looks amazing. Do you have a recipe? How's my presentation?
That's the problem with AI and bots, right? They can get out of control. That's what worries me. But he's right. So that's just a view on how things could look. Will people talk to ads? Will people talk to their computers? Will people talk to their phones? I don't know. A couple of years ago, if you'd have asked people, would they talk to a little dot that sits in their kitchen, they would have probably said no. So it's an interesting area. So the four main areas that we covered kind of all talk to the need to keep the user experience at a premium, right? So we need our interactions to be worthwhile. We need them to be educational. We need them to be entertaining. We need them to be useful. We need them to be delivered to us in the correct format on the correct device. And we need them to be personalized, so delivered to me, because I'm an individual and I really deserve an individual ad. And I should be able to respond to those ads in real time. So how do we do it? Collaboration in the main. So collaboration internally is really important. It's a disparate kind of or disparity between creative, engineers, data people, and so forth. So we have creative and engineers working together in Teed Studio. This has kind of helped us come up with the messaging stuff in particular. The data strategy is key. This is not really easy, though, at all. Ingesting data from all of these different points, understanding all of that data, sharing all of that data within departments. It's an absolute nightmare, but it's something that we need to do in order to get to that vision of delivering one-to-one type video experiences. And invest in AI. So Symphonis, a company, did a survey recently. They surveyed 1,600 business leaders across six different countries. And what they found was a correlation between true revenue growth and those that had invested early in AI. Okay, so I think it's a great time to use AI for innovation. And that's it from me. Thank you very much. Sorry for running over.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. Some questions for Jonathan? Okay. ¿Alguna pregunta para Jonathan? Que yo ya estoy seco, ya no tengo ninguna. No, estas horas ya.
Nadie quiere preguntar nada más.
¿Hay alguien por ahí? ¿Lo veis? ¿Se la ve o se la escucha?
It might be my taxi driver.
Yes.
You have to go, no?
Huh? Yes,
okay. No?
If there's a question, it's fine.
Is there a question? Okay, so thank you very much.
I think you have to take an airplane, no? London,
yes.
Or where are you going now?
London, yeah.
London. Everybody goes to London.
Ah.
Brexit City.
I know.
All right.
Sorry.
Have a nice
thank you.
Buen vuelo hacia Brexit City.